Hello guys, and welcome back to my channel. So in this video today we're going to be discussing about the k-nearest neighbor, which is one of the machine learning algorithms that can be used in making classification or regression predictions. So this video is going to be focusing mostly on the implementation using the R, though there are a lot of resources you can get online and books so that you can get the theoretical mathematics behind the k-nearest neighbor algorithms. So what you're going to do now is just going to create a new folder here, and I'm going to call it the KNN, k-nearest neighbor, and then I'm going to create a new file. I'm going to use a script, an R script, then I'm going to save it. I'm going to save it here, and then I'm going to call it KNN models. Then we're going to save that. So in this video we're going to be using inbuilt data sets that I can show you the method that you can use to implement the algorithm. First thing, we're going to load our libraries. We're going to load the libraries that we're going to be using. So I'm going to be using the the caret library, caret, and we're going to be using this one for splitting the data and also modeling. And in this video I'm going to show you there are very many methods and a lot of libraries that are available out there for performing the KNN in R, but in this case I'm going to be showing the two main methods that you can use to perform the k-nearest neighbor, the KNN algorithm. And then I'm going to use the class package. This one is for the KNN. This is just for the normal KNN. We have other packages such as KKNN, which is also, this is mainly used for the weighted. You can just come and check it here. This is used for the weighted, for the weighted KNN. You can also use this one, which just is going to be used. So let's load these packages. Okay, as they are loading, let's wait for them to load up. And then the next step that we're going to do is to load the data that we're going to be using. As I have said, data has R has a lot of packages, a lot of data sets that you can use. In this case we're going to be using the Iris data set. We're going to use the Iris data set. There it is, so you can just view it. Can view it. This is the kind of data set the iris is. That's what you're talking about. So we have the sepal length, the sepal width, petal length, petal width, and the species. We have three types of species here. As you can see here, species is a factor of three levels. We have the setosa, we have the vesicular, and we have the vaginica. So those are the three species that we're going to be predicting. So this is going to be a classification problem. Another thing that you can look instead, I can also check out the structure of the data using str iris. You can get this numeric is a factor. You can also use the glimpse, which is available from the dplyr package. These are some of the functions that you can use if you want to get an overview of the kind of data that you're dealing with before you start working on it. It's like for you to be able to know what kind of data you're working on. So you can see this one's thing. This is a double. This is a factor. So these are some of the things that you can check on. So the next step that you can do is do some visualization. But in this video, I'm not going to perform any visualization, so you can do it at your own free time. I will make this code available in GitHub. Another thing that you can do to this data is you can perform some normalization, scaling, but in this video I'm not going to do that. But what I want you to do is you can do the normalization, or you can maybe do the scaling. You can perform the scaling, and then you can try and compare your results and my results so that you can be able to know what is the importance of normalization or scaling before performing running the model with the data. So in this case, there are very many types or different types of normalization. Of course, we have the min-max normalization, and we have the z-score normalization. You can try both and see which one is going to work well with the datasets and with the given algorithms. So one thing to note is, as far as I'm concerned, I believe that machine learning is something so technical and experimental. So you can just try to play with the data. You can just try to do normalization before inputting it into the before splitting the data, or you can try to normalize after splitting the data, and you see how these operations are going to affect your modeling. So in this case, the next thing that we're going to be doing, so after you have experimented on that, then from there you can be able to come up with your given procedure which is going to be suitable for your model. So what you're going to do here right now is we can do some data splitting, and again, when you're splitting, there's a lot of methods that you can use, but this is what I'm going to go with. I'm going to use the create data partition, which is available in the current. So we're going to take iris. Then I'm going to say the list equals to false, and then the train set should going to have like 0.7. You can choose whatever you want. Oh, I forgot to set the seed, set.seed. You can just choose any number you want. This one is to ensure that every time we run reproducibility. This is to ensure that every time you're going to be running this splitting, creating the indexes, is going to return the same solution. So for instance, if you're going to use the same seed, you're going to get the same results as me. But if you change the seed value, you're going to get different values because it's doing this operation randomly. So we can create our train sets, our train data splits. Well, I like adding comments. They just make your code look much better. So we're going to say iris, and then we're going to split according to index. We're going to get your train data sets. Now in the environment, you can be able to view. Okay, there's an error. Index not found, so yeah, we didn't run that. So when you do that, you can be able to have a glimpse of your train set. This is how it looks like, and then we can come to the test data split, iris. Then we have our test set. So as you can see, our test set has 45 observations, and our training set has 105 observations. So that is those are our train and our test set. So you can just view them. You can just view them. There we go. So the next thing that we're going to look at, I want us to see if our response variable is balanced, so that we can prevent things to do with so that we can have a case whereby maybe one of the variables is more than the other, and this is going to make it to be like the model is going to be biased towards that particular response variable. So that's where we see when you're working with models and you realize that one class is containing as has a much bigger portion of the response variable than the other. That's why we do things like upsampling or downsampling so that we have a balanced response variable of all the classes, so that the model is not going to be biased towards one of the variables. So we can just table this one. We can just table the iris, not the train. Let's table the train, the spaces. So you can see we have 35, 35, 35. So this one is balanced. So we have a balanced, response variable. We have a balanced response variable. And then we can check up on the test set as well. We can just table this. We can table the tests. Yeah, we can see the test is also balanced as well. So in this case, we can see that our model is not going to be biased towards one of the variables. So in this case, we can just go and fit our model. Can just call it model. Then we have the k and n, the k nearest neighbor. So if you want to get a clear information on what they are going to be putting there, like the variables, all the parameters that you're supposed to include there, you can just come with the help. K nearest neighbor, we have the train, so we have the train. We have the test, and then we have the fact true classification. So the training set contains, so I'm just going to say train equals to train, and then we want what are the variables. Of course, it is going to be in the training set. We are training on these four variables. This is the response, so we're just going to omit the fifth one, and then similar to the tests. Test goes to test, also training on all the first except the third one, and then the class is going to be the train. Of course, these are the classes, the train split, and then k stands for the number of neighbors considered. So we're going to say k equals to 3. We can use any number, but for now let us just stick to 3. So our model has finished training because it's not so much data. So in this case, we can just look at what model is made up of. So you can see these are all the variables that have been predicted. These are the predicted variables according to this test set. So now when you come here, we see the first one is setosa, and it has also predicted setosa. The second class was what? Vesicana, virginica. So yeah, the model has performed pretty well because it has predicted those. These are the actual species, and these are the predicted species. So the next thing that we can do, you can create a confusion matrix. You can just call it CM. Let's just table it. I'm going to table this. So we're going to table the actual and the predicted. So the actual, of course, is the test. These are the actual, and then the predicted one is the model. And then we call CM. This is our, actually this is not a confusion matrix, this is the like a contingency table or something like that. It's just a table. So that means setosa, you are 15 and all of them are predicted correctly. basic color only 14, and the virginica 13, so 2 missed. So to get the confusion matrix of this, we can just use the confusion matrix function. The confusion matrix function from the caret package, and then we have our confusion matrix. So our confusion matrix, as you have registered, the accuracy is 93%, 93, and we are 95% sure that any time the prediction is made, the value is going to be between 81% and 98% accuracy. These are the classes: sensitivity, the Setosa one, basic color. So the model has just basically performed well. It has performed well. Another thing that we can maybe wanting to get is, you can calculate the misclassification error. You can calculate the misclassification error of our model, and we're going to use this package called Shiponov. And then we say misclass, and then in this case you're going to have the test and then the model, which are the actual predicted, the predicted values against the actual values. So we're going to have the classification table. This is the classification table, and then this is the misclassification error. As you can see, our accuracy here is 93.3. So what is 1 minus 0.9333? It is of course this one times 100. So the general, the misclassification error is just 1 minus the accuracy. As you can see here, it's just 6.67%. Right, so misclassification error is just generally 1 minus the accuracy of the particular model. See, this is the simplest way that you can use to perform your KNN classification, and we can see it has given an accuracy of 93%. So the second method that you can use is, you can use caret. Using the caret package, you can use the caret package. In this case, we're going to call this our model 2. Then we're going to use the train packet, the train function, which is for caret. So when you come here, you can just come here and to train and to see what some of the parameters that the train function accepts. So you can just scroll down up to caret. So we have caret KNN, no, caret train. This is what I'm looking for. So we have, it has X, Y, the method. So we need the method. Then if we want it to be pre-processed, let's see, a string vector. If you want it to be scaled, to do some median input, you can just specify it in the pre-process and it's going to do that for you. You can specify the metric that you want it to be. Of course, it depends. If it's going to be a regression, we're going to use RMSE. It's going to be classification. Of course, we're talking about accuracy. And then you can also provide your train control. If it's going to be like some compute, cross-validation, repeated cross-validation, such kind of things, you're going to supply it in the TR control. But in this case, we're just going to make it as simple as possible. Now, since this is our response variable, I'm just going to supply it here. So we're going to use this one here with the formula. The formula, so it's going to be species dot data equals to train, data equals to train, and then the method equals to KNN. Now you might be asking yourself, where am I getting this KNN from? So for you to be able to know like all the methods that you can use in the training using the carrot, you're just going to do names and then get model info, then you just do that, and then you're going to get all the 238 models that methods that you can supply to your train. So that means with the train set you can just perform any form of algorithm that you want. As you can see, you can get the adder, you can get the adder boost, the adder bug method, you can do the CV C5.3, that is for the trees. You can do the C forest, random forest, but in our case we are only interested in the k nearest neighbors, so that's why I have supplied the KNN method. So we can run that, and then we're going to see. So I think I can just copy paste this, then put it in the comments. So the methods, can get the methods using this. And then we have the model too. Now this is our model. So the k-nearest neighbor has 105 samples, which has 4 predictors, 3 classes, which is a response, no pre-processing. But if we had supplied pre-processing, like let's say for example we can try and supply, let's say pre-process equals to scale, let's see, and it to scale all the response variable, the explanatory variables. You can see here it has scaled, so resampling, the bootstrap pre-processing, it has scaled 4. Now these 4, it's these ones here, 1, 2, 3, 4, that is the explanatory variables. Now let's see, it has given a highest accuracy of 94 k of 9, and be without pre-processing it has given accuracy of 95.9, and here we are getting 94, so that's why. Okay, let's just go without scaling. So from there we can just do that, and we're achieving an accuracy of 95%. So we can calculate the response for the confusion matrix. We can get the confusion matrix, and we can the classification table, and then you calculate the confusion matrix from the classification table. And then from there we can be able to see between the first method and the second method which we're going to produce to make a better model for our classification. So in this case, first thing we need to, as you can see, this is a model, so we need to make predictions. We need to make predictions, so we can just do pred, then we can make a predict. Predict using model 2, and then the new data equals to test, and then we run that to get the prediction. You can see here the prediction has three levels, and also check them through this one, can run that, and then we see that. So of course we're going to have 43, 44, 45 as expected, 45 observations. And then we can create our confusion matrix, our classification table, I mean. We can create our classification table, which is going to be going to table the tests, which are actually the actual, these are going to be the actual predicted actually classes, and then these are going to be the predicted classes. So we can run this and see how the table looks like. So this is the table. Now comparing this with the first table, okay, let me show you something. When using training, these are some things you're going to be using when you are doing some real analysis and to compare this. Now you can see the first, this is the second one. It has made 15 right predictions. This 15 right prediction are wrong, 13 wrong. This one has made 15, 14, 13. So from this judgment, we can see that this, the second method, is already winning. So let us see if that is true or we are wrong. So we can do that by calculating the confusion matrix. The confusion matrix of CM of CT, the classification table. So from the confusion matrix, we can see that it has achieved an accuracy of 95%. And this one achieved an accuracy of 93%. So the second method is already winning. And then we can calculate the misclassification. Of course, we get the actual ones. And then we get the predicted values. Get the misclassification. So the rate, the error rate in this case, it's 3.9. While the error rate using the first method, it was 6.67. So from these answers, we can see that from these insights, we can see that the second method performed better than the first method. So guys, this has been it for the KNN. So we shall see you in the next video. Thank you guys.